أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد، اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. أما بعد، السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. As I speak to you this evening, it is almost the 10th night of the month of Ramadan. And it's a reminder that about one third of the holy month has passed or is passing. And if we look at our prayers, our fasting, if we look at our recitation of the Quran, by this time there should be a marked improvement in the quality of our prayer, in the quality of our recitation, in the manner in which we behave with our family and with our friends, in the way we're able to control our desire and our anger. And so if we find that there is a difference, it means that fasting is playing the role it is supposed to play in our lives. It's having the impact it is supposed to have upon our souls. And if we find that there is no difference, there is no impact, the way I pray is exactly the way I used to pray 2 weeks ago. The way I speak to people is the same way I used to speak to them 2 weeks ago. Then I have to put more effort. I have to pick up the slack. I have to so-called tighten the belt. And I have 2 weeks left, or rather two more 10 days left, 20 days left to be able to do that. But I will remind myself and I will remind you that the next 10 days will pass by just as quickly as the first 10 days. And the days after that will also pass by very quickly as well. This is a time for us to reflect and to renew our commitment once again towards achieving the goals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to achieve in the month of Ramadan. Our conversations have centered around the structure of the Quran. We have asked some very important questions, and tonight we'll be asking another important question. Before I get to that question, I do want to address perhaps a concern that perhaps someone might think that a lot of our conversations are theoretical conversations. They are conceptual conversations. We work with a lot of concepts and we delve into ayat of the Quran, and that some of these questions could have been answered with much simpler answers, with easier answers, with stories and examples. And that's true. We could have answered them all in that manner. But the question I ask myself and I ask you as well is, how long will our understanding of the Quran be a superficial understanding of the Quran? And how long will the reality of the Quran be veiled and hidden from us? And for how long will our answers just be like sound bites or talking points? And these sound bites and talking points, are they going to help us to understand the reality of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And for that reason, we have been going into some of the depths of the Quran. Now tonight, the question I'd like to pose is that, why was there a gradual revelation to the Quran? As we know, the Quran was revealed over a period of 23 years. From the time the Prophet of Allah was of the age of 40 until he passed away at the age of 63. And as various incidents would come across in the Prophet's life, then a revelation would come to the Holy Prophet. Why wasn't the Quran revealed in one place at one time And why wasn't it presented as a singular book to the people? When we normally publish a book, we don't normally publish chapters of it. We put the chapters together and we publish it as a single book. Now that's a question that even the mushrikeen of Mecca had. And they posed it as an objection or a criticism against the Prophet and the Quran. If we can look at the next slide, there is a verse that actually speaks to this question. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا And those who do not have faith, they say about this Quran, لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنُ جُمْلَةً وَاحِدًا Why isn't the Quran revealed all at once? One jumla, together. They had heard that the books that came before the Quran were all revealed at one time. Now there is a difference of opinion and a discussion amongst the scholars of the Quran whether the previous books were revealed instantaneously or the previous books were revealed gradually. In any case, the mushrikeen had heard that the previous books had been revealed instantaneously. So they asked, why hasn't this Quran also been revealed like that? And I want to first answer this question with some of the answers that have been given. And if we can go to the next slide. These are some simple and straightforward answers that we can find explained by the scholars of the Quran. So if we can move to the next slide. The first answer that has been given is that the guidance of the Quran was in accordance with the growth of the community. The community that was in Mecca was very different from the community that was in Medina. The community in Mecca was a very nascent community. It was just beginning the struggle. Many of the early Muslims were not completely aware of the teachings of Islam and all the aqidah and the beliefs of Islam. They also lived as a minority within a majority. The situation then was very different. And when they migrate to Medina, now they slowly become a majority. Many of them are well aware now of the teachings of Islam. It's a period of time that they can now start practicing Islam. And we notice that some of the detailed laws of Islam, of the Sharia, are presented in Medina. Also in Medina, they had different stages. There were stages when they were still not ready for engagement with the enemy. And then there were stages where they were ready for engagement with the enemy. So when the Quran was revealed gradually, it was giving guidance to the new Muslim community in accordance to what they needed at that time. It also allowed Muslims to grow gradually and slowly come to accept some of the new teachings and some of the new rulings of Islam. For example, when it came to the prohibition of alcohol, it took a gradual process to remove the consumption of alcohol from the general usage in society. And therefore you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gradually reveals the prohibition of the consumption of alcohol. That's one reason that has been given. The second reason is that it offered an opportunity to provide a proof for the prophethood of the Holy Prophet. The people of Mecca, sometimes the Ahlul Kitab, would come to the Holy Prophet and say, if you truly are a prophet of God, then tell us about these stories that appear, for example, in the previous texts or that are known to the people of the book, but generally they were not known well to the people of Mecca and Medina, the people of Hijaz. For example, Surah Al-Kahf was revealed in response to their questions. They came to the Holy Prophet and they said that there are three stories, one about the sleepers in the cave, and the second one about this wise man, and the third one about Dhul-Qarnayn. Tell us, what are the details of their stories? And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals that when they ask about it, ويسألونك عن ذي القرنين. O Prophet, they ask you about ذو القرنين. قل سأتلو عليكم من نبئه ذكرى. Tell them, I will mention to you from his story a reminder or something from his story. So when these revelations came at that time, they were a miracle that proved the prophethood of the Holy Prophet. Thirdly, it's also a miracle of the Quran. The fact that it was revealed over a period of 23 years. And you find that there is no discrepancy in the Quran. What was revealed in the year 40, when the Prophet of Allah was 40 years of age, and what was revealed when the Prophet of Allah was 63 years of age, there is no discrepancy in it. The Almighty says, if it was from other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اِخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا, they would have found a lot of discrepancy in it. The fact that it was revealed over a period of 23 years. Any human being, when they write books, and if you see the books that they wrote at the age of 63 versus the books they wrote at the age of 40, the books they wrote after acquiring certain experiences, the books they wrote before acquiring those experiences, the books they wrote in their homeland versus the books that they wrote when they were refugees, there's a stark difference in the content and the style, but not so in the Quran. And that's one of the proofs of the divine source of the Quran. And lastly, it also allowed for ease of recording and ease of understanding in the community as well. People would not have been able to understand 6,000 odd verses revealed at the same time, but they could understand it and memorize it when it was revealed piecemeal. Now, for more information, you can go to the book Quranic Sciences, and there is further information in there. But I do want to come back to the reason that is proffered by the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after narrating the criticism or the objection of the mushrikeen, he also gives a reason to us. And the reason that he gives is, كَذَٰلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. It is so, O Prophet of Allah, because we want to make firm your heart. نُثَبِّتَ comes from doing isbat of something, making it firm, making it ثَابِت. Okay? We wanted to make it firm in your heart. What does it mean when the Almighty says, we wanted to make the Quran firm in your heart? So in order to do that, we're going to first look at some discussions that come up in the Quranic sciences, and we want to take gradual steps at answering this question. And we're going to take one or two steps back first. So if we can go to the next slide, let's begin to talk about revelation and the fact there are two types of revelation. As you know, there is an instantaneous revelation of the Quran, and there is a gradual revelation of the Quran. The Arabic term for the instantaneous revelation is daf'i. For those who speak Urdu, sometimes you say ikdafa, right? At once. And the Arabic term for the gradual revelation is tadrij, tadriji, okay? Something that's revealed slowly. In the Quran, different terms are used for it. The Arabic term in the Quran for the instantaneous revelation is inzal. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. We have revealed it on the night of Qadr. Shahru Ramadan alladhi unzila fihi al-Quran. The month of Ramadan in which the Quran was revealed. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatin mubarakah. We have revealed it, done the inzal on a blessed night. Okay? And the Arabic Quranic term for the gradual revelation is tanzil. Tanzilum min rabbil alameen. A revelation from the Lord of the universe. Now we know that the instantaneous revelation happened on the night of Qadr. And we also know that the gradual revelation happens over a period of 23 years. One of the things that we will want to look at today is what is the difference between the gradual revelation and the instantaneous revelation? In the sense that what form did the gradual revelation take? We know what the form the gradual revelation took. It took the form of words, the form of sentences in the Arabic language that came to the Holy Prophet, that had examples within it, that had stories within it. But what about the instantaneous revelation? That which is revealed to the Holy Prophet on the night of Badr, is it the same Quran in the same form, or is it something that is slightly different? So I've written, if you can see in the notes, that it's like a faculty, or it's like a malaka. I've put an asterisk next to it. Inshallah, we'll go in some detail over that. Now, if we can go to the next slide, we first have to look at the meaning of nuzul, of revelation. The word nuzul in Arabic comes from, you know, nazala, nazala meaning to come down, nuzul meaning to come down. For example, when the rain comes down, anzalna minas samai ma'an, we make the water come down from the sky. When we talk about the coming down of the Quran, the descent of the Quran, what does it mean when we say the descent of the Quran? Now, I know that growing up, we were explained that the Quran was in a very high place, and then slowly it was brought down to the earth. It was brought down on the night of Qadr. It was brought down over a period of 23 years. Jibra'il would bring it to the Holy Prophet. What does it mean to bring it down? Does it mean that that book that was there was brought down to this earth? So we know that the Quran has two realities at least to it. The first reality of the Quran is the reality which is found in Lawh Mahfuz. Allah says in the Quran, بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ, rather it is the Quran which is Majid, فِي لَوْحٍ مَحْفُوظٍ, in the guarded tablet. Now, the Quran that is in the guarded tablet is not in the form of words. It's not in the form of sentences. It's not in the Arabic language. It doesn't have stories in it. It doesn't have examples in it. That Quran is a singular, non-compound reality. It is what we call basit. Okay? There are no parts in it. There are no separations in it. It's a singular reality. That's one reality of the Quran. And the second reality of the Quran is the one that we have in our hands, what is between the two covers. And that is in the form of the Arabic language, in the form of words and sentences. It has names of people and places. It refers to the Prophet of Allah and what was happening around the Holy Prophet. There is that reality of the Quran. So let's start making a few points about that then. Firstly, revelation does not mean that the first reality, which is in Lawh Mahfuz, the way it is in Lawh Mahfuz, was brought down and presented to the people. That before revelation, it was in Lawh Mahfuz, and after revelation, it is now in the hands of the people. No, before and after revelation, that reality remains in Lawh Mahfuz. It's never removed from Lawh Mahfuz. It remains over there. So what do we mean when we say it has been revealed? What we mean by that, if we can go to the next slide, is that that reality that is in Lawh Mahfuz was put into the form of words, into the form of sentences, into the Arabic language, into a manner that people in this world would be able to understand it, they would be able to communicate it, they would be able to learn it. That reality being manifested into words and sentences is revelation. Allah says in the Quran, Inna anzalnahu, we have revealed it. It meaning what? That singular reality. Qur'anan Arabiyyan, as a recitation, meaning we have put it into words. Words which are clear. Words which are in the Arabic language. La'allakum ta'qilun, so that you may use your intellect, so that you may reason it to understand that higher reality. And I know that there's been a lot of conceptual discussion over here, but there's a beautiful example that some of our scholars give to help us understand the concept of revelation. You know, when we talk about something descending, it can take on two forms. It can come to us in two ways. Sometimes when you talk about something going from up to down, it's like taking a book that's on a higher shelf and putting it into a lower shelf. Now it's no longer in the higher shelf. It is at the lower shelf where even a child can reach it and pick it up. For example, with rain as well. It is at a higher sky, a higher level of the atmosphere, comes down to the earth. That's one type of descent. There is a second type of descent. And that is, imagine somebody holding a rope and holding it from a higher position. And they lower the rope. Now, the rope is descending. But it doesn't mean that it has left its origin. The rope remains in its origin. One end of it is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the other end of it is with the people. Okay? Now, of course, we've used the example of the Quran. But let's say when it is being lowered, one end is at the source, the other end is at the recipient. The Quran is more like a rope than it is like rain coming down, right? The revelation of the Quran, it has a reality in the Lawh-e Mahfuz. It has a reality on the earth as well. And those realities are connected. The fourth Imam, Imam Sajjad, alayhi afdalu salati wa salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad, he says, Kitabullahi hablum mamdudum min as-sama'i. The book of God is an extended rope from the sky. Meaning, as a person holds on to this rope and they continue to climb this rope, they get into higher and higher and higher realities of the Quran. And the highest reality of the Quran is that reality that is found in Lawhul Mahfuz. And we're beginning to understand the Quran has layers of realities. In any case, we continue and we come to the, we start with the instantaneous revelation before we're going to go into the gradual revelation of the Quran. So let me summarize what we've said so far. We've said that the Quran has an instantaneous revelation and the Quran has a gradual revelation. We took a step back and we said, what does revelation mean to begin with? And we saw that revelation meant that idea which was profound, which was singular, was put into words, was put into sentences, was put into a manner that we could understand. That is revelation. And we also saw that it is a connected and continuous reality. It's not that those ideas have now been put into our hands. No, those ideas or that idea, that truth, that reality has been manifested to us. And what we have in our hands is the lowest manifestation of that reality. And it is a beautiful manifestation, the most accurate manifestation, the most eloquent manifestation, the most comprehensive manifestation of it. And our role when we do tafakkur and tadabbur is to go from this lower form and slowly into the higher understanding of the Quran. Now, the question we had asked earlier was that why was it important for the singular reality to be revealed gradually over a period of 23 years? And the Quran tells the Holy Prophet, we have done that so that we may make it firm in your heart. Now that's where we're trying to aim at with our discussion. But before we come to that, I want to first look at the instantaneous, the daf'i revelation of the Quran. And perhaps that's where we will stop this evening. The question I want to ask now, since we understand the realities of the Quran, is what was revealed on the night of Qadr to the Holy Prophet? Was that reality revealed to him? That's not possible. That reality remains where it is. We don't talk about that revelation of that. If it's revealed, it's no longer that. Okay? It is a manifestation of it. Or is it the one that we have in our hands? So the idea I'm going to be sharing with you is something that is shared by Ayatollah Jawadi Amuli. He's got a thematic tafsir of the Quran, a tafsir which is mawdu'i. And there he's got a book on Quran dar Quran. So Quran as explained in light of the Quran itself. These are the points that he makes. He says that, well, it cannot be the reality of Allahul Mahfuz, right? Because on that night, we are told that the Quran was revealed. Once it is revealed, it's not that singular reality. فِيهَا يُفْرَقُ كُلُّ أَمْرٍ حَكِيمٍ. On the night of Qadr, everything is given specification, it's given measurement, it's given particularity. Well, if the Quran has been revealed, it also must come out of being a singular reality and take on specification, take on some type of detail to it. It also cannot be the reality of the words and reality of the language, the book that we have in our hand. That depended on the causes of revelation that came over a period of time. So Ayatollah Jawadi Amuli says, and I know this will be a little bit difficult to understand, but it will be important to understand nonetheless. He says that it is both measured, meaning given specification, and it is also general at the same time. Not at the level of detail that you find in the Quran that I and you recite. And the example he gives is the example of a malaka. For example, we say that a faqih has a malaka, has the faculty, has the ability of doing ijtihad. It doesn't mean that he knows all of the answers, right? Of course, that will depend when he does his ijtihad, when he practices that ability, when he practices that talent, he applies it to a particular aspect of the fiqh, then he will get the answer. And he has the ability to get the answer. He has the ability to get the solution. And it's much easier for him to understand what is being derived over there. But on the other hand, the ability that he has is not a detailed ability. It's a general ability, right? And that's why he says, what was revealed to the Holy Prophet on the night of Qadr is something that was general, like a faculty, like a malaka. It was revealed as that reality. It was revealed as that understanding and not something that was specific and something that was detailed. Right? Why? And that's a question as well. We asked the question, why was there a gradual revelation to the Quran? It's fair enough to ask, why was there an instantaneous revelation to the Quran? I want to come back to a point that we have been making throughout our lecture series, in that the process of revelation by no means was an easy process. By no means is a simple process. Revelation is no easy occurrence. Revelation is something very difficult, something very profound. It not only requires the recipient to reveal, it also requires a qabiliyat. It also requires a capacity and a capability in the receiver of revelation as well. And we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing the Holy Prophet from the time he was born to be able to receive divine revelation. He's strengthening the Prophet of Allah. He's purifying the Holy Prophet. The first Imam, Imam Ali alayhi afdalu salati wa salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, he says in Nahj al-Balagha that from the time the Holy Prophet was born, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed an angel with him who would teach him makarim al-akhlaq, who would teach him the most noble of character traits, who would teach him what the Prophet of Allah needed to learn. We see that even before the first revelation comes to the Holy Prophet, 3 years in advance, from the age of 37, the Prophet of Allah starts to see ar-ru'ya as-sadiqa, true dreams. The Prophet of Allah starts to see visions as well. And then when the first revelation comes to the Holy Prophet, then the Prophet's heart is ready now to receive that revelation. We see how much the Holy Prophet used to struggle when the revelation would come to him. So one of the ways to prepare the Holy Prophet to receive the detailed manifestation of the Quran was to give him a general manifestation of the Quran, to make it like a malaka in his heart, so that when the details were revealed, when the verses were revealed, they would be easier for him to understand, easier for him to receive, easier for him to process, and then to communicate to others as well. كَذَلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. We revealed it gradually. We say the same thing about the instantaneous revelation, but we revealed it gradually so that we may make it firm in your heart. Now, inshallah, tomorrow evening, we'll speak in a little more detail about this, and we'll refer to this verse of the Quran, and we'll see what Allama Tabatabai has to say about this verse and the reason for why we have a gradual revelation of the Holy Quran. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us understand the reality of the Quran, to make the concepts of the Quran firm into our heart, and to help us to understand and experience and appreciate the higher layers and the higher realities of the Quran. Wassalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.